Set of skills. Skills I've acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you.
Okay, now what?
Buckle up.
Let's play.
What's this guy supposed to be, the ultimate badass?
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
I want to have a little fun.
Groovy.
Hey.
See, there's a war going on here, and they don't take prisoners.
Time to nut up or shut up.
What are you gonna do for me?
What do you think I'm gonna do? I'm gonna save the fucking day.
Drumroll, please. Drumroll.
Hi, I'm Kirk Nolan, and welcome to The Box. Merry Christmas, everybody. Happy holidays. I know it doesn't feel that way right now. So many Americans dying. If you're somewhere else in the world, I hope that you are all safe. We're having a hell of a holiday here in the U.S. And I want to remind people that this is the time of year to look out for one another as much as we can. There are Americans dying every 30 seconds now from COVID-19. So we've got to be each other's stewards. We've got to help each other. Otherwise, this is going to take us down, way down, further than it was now. So grab your kids, grab your wife, wrap your arms around your friends when you can, in a safe way, and let people know you love them. I mean, it's as easy as a Zoom call, isn't it now? To talk to somebody face to face, to let them know that you love them, that it matters. Don't let those moments go by. Don't forget to do that before it's too late. I have spent the last 5 years making sure I told all my friends and family and people that I love how I feel about them. I've made videos. I've told stories, and I'm going to continue that and let people know how special they are in this world to me, and that I would not be here if not for them. And that, my friends, is the greatest Christmas gift of all. I say this to you knowing what I'm talking about, because in 2015, on a Christmas night, I died. And I never thought I would be back here again. And here I am with a second chance. Merry Christmas, everyone.
You better watch out. You better not cry.
You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town.
I always love Frankie. He makes me feel like a gangster. He's making a list. He's checking it twice. He's going to find out who's naughty or nice. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good. For goodness sakes, oh, you better watch out. I love this version. It's like you can be a gangster in a Christmas song. That's why I dress the way. I'm trying to have fun on this day. This is a day that I died on this day.
And whenever it comes around Christmas, I just feel for everybody who has been through something so horrible, and it falls on Christmas. And you just, you know, you have to live with that for the rest of your life. And I have these memories of dying that haunt me and follow me around in every Christmas. It's just, so I had decided when I was going to do the show that I wasn't going to talk about anything super depressing and even go back and talk about my life, because I'm here and it's 5 years later and I feel good and I feel healthy and I'm in the middle of a pandemic and I'm quarantined, but I'm building my own show and I'm having so much fun. And I don't want Christmas to be ruined for me. I don't want that, you know? So I'm trying to do the best I can in the solitude of my own life, because I'm alone outside of when Deborah's home. But other than that, I'm home alone, like many of you are. So I'm trying to have fun. And I'm trying to go down memory lane now to this other Kirk that, you know, was a comedian and a troublemaker. And I liked a lot of that Kirk. There's a lot of things about him I liked. There's a lot of things about him I didn't like, but there's a lot of things about him I liked. And this Kirk in this life, I've tried to take some of that Kirk and filter it in with this new Kirk, this K2.0 Kirk, a new improved version of the old Kirk. So it's Christmas and I just decided I want to have some fun on Christmas and I want to have some fun with all of you, my tribe. And so I just thought I'm going to have some fun on Christmas and play some Christmas music and movies and mashups and cool fun things and old rants and things I've done over the years about Christmas and talked about it and talked about the craziness of this world without it being too deep and too disturbing. And you're going to meet some great artists and some mashups, things that really has made me the artist that I am today, this style, this look that you're seeing, this mixing and melding of hip hop and all my influence from Ali to Public Enemy, which is up at the top, to just hip hop and everything combined with stand up and videos and my love for interviewing people. It's all here now for me to just have fun with in my own little world now, because a lot of us are in the same place. It's just, you're in your own world. So you've got to do like Andy Kaufman did and have fun and just have fun and talk about the things you want to talk about, your truth. My truth happens to be I see things in a very dark, dark way, way darker than a lot of people want to go down that road. But it's where, how I see this world and how I talk about it and how I cope with it. And so that's what I'm doing today on Christmas. I'm coping with it by being a gangster and singing some Frank Sinatra fucking Christmas music, bitches. Uh-oh. Did I lose it? Is this it? When I cry, you better pout. I'm telling you why.
Santa Claus is coming in to town. He's making a list, checking it twice. Gonna find out who's naughty and nice.
Santa Claus
is coming to town.
You don't even have to know how to sing like me.
He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out.
You better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Oh, the best! Frank, the best! Oh, love Frank Sinatra. Love Frank Sinatra. The best. Old Blue Eyes. And so this is Christmas for me, and it's Christmas for a lot of you. And a lot of people have not been down this road before. It's a hard, hard road, brothers and sisters. It is a hard road, but it is a road that that you can win, you can survive it, you can rebuild, and you can become brand new again. Everything new has been torn down, all right? This, we're all changing now. This is the breaking down period of all of us coming to terms with who we are as human beings. This is it. This is humanity vomiting up humanity now from all the shit we have done. And now we're here. And this is self-discovery time for everyone. This is where it begins. It begins with destruction. It begins with the destruction of everything that you have held sacred and believed in and thought was real. And it's all been smashed apart in a million different pieces. And it's littered in front of your face. That is what happened to me 5 years ago. And I had to find a way to pick up those broken pieces like my mother did with puzzles that she used to have on these dining room tables when I was growing up, thousands and thousands of pieces to keep her mind in shape, to keep her mind in order, and to just take those pieces and try to figure out the puzzle. And so that's what we have here. With the box, it is a puzzle in my mind that has been created with the art of video creation, the art of editing, the art of storytelling. And I was a comedian and a hip-hop connoisseur my whole life. In fact, coming out of this experience, I was teaching young people about hip-hop and the beginnings of these great artists. And so it has made me and molded me into everything that I am today, along with walking through the valley of the shadow of death and coming back out of it with my soul still intact. Battered, beaten, scarred. I'm full of scars, but I am still standing. And it's Christmas. It's Christmas, and it's 5 years of me rebuilding. So here I am now in the midst of another apocalypse, telling my stories, talking about this incredible journey that has brought me to this place, out of the abyss back to here, only to be thrown right back into the abyss again. But this time I'm not alone, because there's 70 million of you out there that are just like me now, looking for some sense, make some sense of all of this on this ball of confusion, this road of desperation and despair, this dystopian world that has just sprung up around you as if it was always there and you just didn't see it.
You are going to start seeing now the creation of this new show that mixes all these different forms of media into one cohesive art form. This is The Box. I've been recording my life for over 10 years now, over a decade I've been building. I didn't know I was doing this. I didn't know I was building an online documentary.
Right.
But I've been building an online documentary in increments of 1 minute pieces. And now that I've come out the other end, I'm beginning to bring all those one-minute pieces together into mini documentaries like Russian Dolls. All the pieces go together.
Creativity always builds on the path.
Nighttime. It's where all my thoughts come together. It's why I can't sleep. Wake at night, staring at the computer, people constantly chattering. Seem to shut my brain off. Building, creating, discovering new ways to express myself. That's the true path of the artist. Trying to find a way to keep reinventing yourself, even in the face of tragedy and heartache and things that seem to knock you down to a place where you seem like you're never going to be able to get up again. And you reach one more rung on that ladder. Yourself up. One more knot in that length of rope. You grab just one more time. You think maybe this will be the time. Maybe this is my shot. Maybe this is my chance. Maybe this is my one opportunity to make a difference in the world. We all want to make a contribution to making the world a better place to live. So much so it drives some of us mad.
All right. Welcome back. I hope you're having a good time. I hope you're enjoying the show thus far. And now comes a point where I get to introduce some of my friends. Friends who have helped me to make it through this journey on this crazy mental institution in space. I'm still in my Frank voice. But this is one of them right here. You're seeing him right now. This goofy guy here, who is basically my shaman. I use that phrase because I saw Public Enemy, Chuck D from Public Enemy, call one of his friends his shaman, like his closest friend, and that's what Dave is to me. This is David Santo. He is a Renaissance man in every sense of the word. The man can do it all, and when he dives into something, he takes it on with the kind of vigor and attention to detail that I do as an artist. And when I say he can do it all, he does it all. He's been a rock star. He's a screenwriter. He's a musician. He can play any instrument. Here's a great example of him. When he was like 16, he wrote a symphony, like at 16. So this is my buddy Dave, and now I'm going to introduce you to him because we sat down for an interview. We've done lots of interviews, but we sat down for an interview about the pandemic. But before I introduce you to him, I want you to hear this magical anthem that he has created, because a lot of people think this is a show I'm creating. This is not a show. This is my testimonial to the world. This is the beginning of my testimonial to the world. And Dave has been creating testimonials to the world for a long time. And this song that he created just holds a special place in my heart. It is Everybody is Beautiful. And it is an anthem. It is a testimonial to the world that we are living in today.
Roll it. Action.
In the night we come together, a sweet ballet that lasts forever. I see the light that shines deep in you, yeah. Another day, another news, oh, oh, the way they are. Everybody.
Bingo. That's what I'm looking for.
We're living in this crazy pandemic. How are you doing, by the way, in it all? Because I know that you struggle in this just like I do, because you have some self-health issues that really make this a lot worse for you. Can you explain that to our viewers?
I've had 14 operations in the last 10 years, and some of them have worked and some of them have not worked. So I have a very uneven physical existence. Now, having said that, a pandemic like this doesn't pose that big of a problem for me, because as a writer, I spend the primary amount of my time in front of a computer. And also for years and years, I've lived a life of quiet reflection. So in a very contrarian sort of way, this is dovetailed into a really good, this is dovetailed into a really good time for me, creatively speaking. And just on a personal note, my dad had to go to war. All I have to do is go to the couch. So I think I can navigate this pretty well.
As you hear me talk to Dave, I want people to really understand Dave is a true Renaissance man in every sense of the word when I say that. I mean, he's pretty much done it all in his lifetime. He started out a life of, like most people, I think, reaching for the stars. Where I was a successful comedian, Dave was already touring around the country with a band and busting it out and on the top charts and the whole deal. So this is the reason I'm talking with him today, because he has been through the deepest parts of the valley and come back out of it. And during this time, I'm trying to connect and talk to some of my artistic friends who already have had a process in place. And so for them, you just heard him. For him, he's already, this is something that helps him move forward, just like me. I'm just, you know, I've already been in this place. I've already been quarantined for a long time. So have you. So we just pick up our process. But a lot of other people don't know how to do that, especially young people right now. And I'm watching a lot of people crashing right now because they're heading down this road of not really knowing what to do. So let's go back to the early days of your career and begin with how this all began for you, how you started out as a singer and a songwriter. Is that correct?
The year was 1973, and I was in the basement of my grandmother's house in Dearborn, Michigan, right around the corner here.
Shit, you really took us back in the time machine there, didn't you? It's like Marty McFly over here. He just went, I did 1973. Let's go.
You could buy a brand new car for $2,000.
That's crazy, isn't it?
So my grandmother had a drum set in her basement, and she showed me how to play drums to Surf and Safari by the Beach Boys.
Wow.
And that's all it took. I was hooked. I knew right then and there I wanted to make rock and roll records. And that's exactly what I did. 1995 was the first album, and 1990 was the first, and 1995 was the second album. And after doing music, that's when I changed to becoming a screenwriter, and I've never looked back.
So when you look at those early days of being a singer and songwriter and all the things that you did, because I mean, you had like a trailer of people and you had a crew of people and you were a real rock star. So what are some of the things that you can look back on now as an artist and go, oh, that's the beginning of my process. Like that was the beginning of what I started to do that has made me the disciplined person that I am today to be able to survive this.
Good question. The first thing is that is applicable to this, time is, do not wait for the completion of anything. That's not a thing. Don't do that. So if you want to be a rock star, but you work on a pig farm for 20 years, after 20 years, pigs are your style. So if you have an idea about what you want your life to be, do not wait for the completion of something to get started. So if you want to make it to the top of Mount Sinai, start walking towards Mount Sinai.
That's what you learned early on in those days from mistakes?
I didn't know I was learning it. That was just my instinct. Now looking back on it, I went, oh, that was a really valuable asset that I didn't realize. Just kind of that, for lack of a better word, blind ambition to do something.
if you're tuning in, welcome to The Box, a living documentary. Yeah. It's my video memoirs and also my show where I'm talking to others about the process. You see, the process is what will save your life. It will save you above everything else. And I guess when I'm talking about the process a little bit, I'm talking about a ritual, a routine. When you build a good process, you're building something that you don't think about anymore. It's like martial arts. You were a martial artist in the early days, correct?
Yes.
Yes. So, you know, part of martial arts is getting the katas and the movements down so you don't think about it anymore. It's the same with singing and songwriting, I would imagine. It's the same with editing. You have to get away from, you have to get your mind away from thinking about the keys and the keystrokes and where you're going to move pieces of the puzzle, because that's getting in the way of your brain and the story. And once you can get all the movements and the motions automatic in that process, then you clear your mind away from all the other shit and you start really focusing on your craft. So you are one of the most disciplined artists I have ever met, probably at the top of the heap. And so did that start early on with you, or did you discover it later? Do you look back now and go, oh, there's a moment where I can see I started to really embrace, you know, this discipline as an artist, this process?
Everything you just said was true, like that certain element of muscle memory. Yeah. But that actually starts us in the middle of the journey. What happens before that is discovering your purpose. Gotcha. And if you have not discovered your purpose, you are a rudderless ship. So before we get to the ritualized practice, before we get to the dedication, every moment that you don't know your purpose is just another moment you're throwing away. So we really have to establish what your purpose is, and then we can figure out how to invent a system to go about doing that. And I want to mention that your purpose in life is not a person, place, or a thing. It is a feeling. It's the feeling you get when you're doing something and you know everything in the world is right. You know it's not right, but it feels that way. Whatever that is, that's your purpose. Kirk?
Love what you said, everything that you said. That's why I love Dave so much. A lot of scientists have already been talking about the disruption of the economy that was going to occur from AI. Nobody imagined what we're in right now. And so they were preparing for it because they said the biggest part of that disruption is people are going to lose their jobs. And once they lose their jobs, they will lose their purpose. So when we start talking about purpose, and I keep telling people part of getting a process is part of finding your purpose, chasing after your purpose. The problem with that is there are people listening to us right now going, what the fuck are you guys talking about? I've been looking for a purpose my whole fucking life. And in the middle of trying to find your purpose, you got people that are constantly telling you, oh, yeah, you want to be a rock star? Yeah, do you make any money doing that? How's that going? You know what I mean? That's a hobby. That's not a job. That's a this. That's not a job. That's not a goal. That's not a this. So how did you combat those things?
First of all, another really great question. My friendly advice then on if you don't know your purpose, it hasn't been revealed to you. Are you ready for this one, Kirk?
Yes.
Live as if your father is dead. I'm not saying he has to be dead. I'm not saying I want that, but I mean your father, my father, whoever else is listening, live as if your father is dead. And there was three things growing up that you wanted to do that you were unable to do because your parents just didn't have the money, or your parents were disinterested, or whatever the circumstances that life had to offer. Find those three things. For instance, when you were a child, you said, hey, Dad, I want to be a golfer. And Dad said, we can't afford golf clubs. The end. That was it. And a year goes by. You go, hey, Mom, I want to take flying lessons. And you go, she goes, we can't afford flying lessons. The end. And then the next year comes, you go, I want to put my drum set in the bedroom. And they go, well, that's just a dumb thing to do, so we're not doing that. Well, now that you're grown up, it's time for you to go back and revisit those things that were prohibited, the things you specifically asked for, and it's your job to do them now. So on day one, you go to the driving range with a buddy and you hit some balls. On day number two, you take a discovery flight at a local airport. It's about $100. And on day number three, you put your drum set in your bedroom. So that's how you you have to go back and repurpose those things you asked for and were denied. And then you rediscover them as a grown-up.
I am so thankful to have a friend like him, because he has kept my head on straight in these 5 years that I've been here. He has always been there for me when I needed someone to talk to or needed a helping hand. And me and Dave are in the same predicament with maladies that prevent us from moving outside of our quarantine area. So I miss my friend a lot. I miss him. I miss the afternoons we used to have sitting around eating lunch and talking about the universe and talking about art and building art together. And this is part of what makes quarantine so hard for all of us, is missing our family. And this is part of my family.
Rain, I don't mind. Shine, the weather's fine. I can show you. Whether it rains or it shines, it's just a state of mind. Can you hear me? Baby, can you hear me? Shine, the weather's fine. Everybody's beautiful the way they are.
And now you can see why I call Dave my shaman. He's my spiritual advisor. He always has the best advice and help in these very turbulent times that we're living in, where things just change on a daily basis, like they just changed again this week with this.
Tonight, flights banned from the United Kingdom, chaos at airports and train stations after a growing number of countries halt incoming planes from the UK as a new, more contagious COVID strain spreads there. Will the US ban flights next?
Tonight, the British Isles are increasingly isolated as countries around the world race to block all flights from the United Kingdom and stop the spread of a new mutant strain of COVID-19.
The new variant is out of control and we need to bring it under control.
The announcement left passengers stranded. The new coronavirus strain isn't more deadly, nor is it thought to be more resistant to vaccines, but it does appear to spread 70% faster than the original virus.
Strains are popping up in multiple different places in the UK and Denmark, in the Philippines, and I suspect some strains like that may already be circulating in the United States.
Wow, now in the UK, people can't even have fucking Christmas now. My friends in the UK, I love you, all right? I hope everything gets better there. I hope you're all safe. I hope you're okay, I know how difficult this is. This is now an incredible moment of loss for us all. This is the death of so many things that we have used as cornerstones in our life and our existence. And when people are hit with this kind of loss, this kind of devastation, they don't know how to come back out of it. It's like being hit by a tsunami.
I'm old. All right, I'm an old man.
And what that means is that I've survived so far, and a lot of people I've known and loved did not. I've lost friends, best friends, acquaintances, co-workers, grandparents, moms, relatives, teachers, mentors, students, neighbors, and a host of other folks. I have no children, and I can't even imagine the pain it must be to lose a child. But here's my two cents. I wish I could say you get used to people dying, but I never did. I don't want to. It tears a hole through me whenever somebody I love dies, no matter what the circumstances are. But I don't want it to not matter. I don't want it to be something that just passes. My scars are a testament to the love and the relationships that I had for and with that person. And if the scar is deep, so was the love. So be it. Scars are a testament to life. Scars are a testament that I can love deeply, live deeply, and be cut and even gouged, and that I can heal and continue to live and continue to love. And the scar tissue stronger than the original flesh ever was. Scars are a testament to our life. Scars are only ugly to the people who can't see. As for grief, well, you'll find that comes in waves. When the ship first wrecked, you're drowning with wreckage all around you. Everything's floating around you, and it reminds you of the beauty and the magnificence of the ship that was and is no more. And all you can do is just float. You find some piece of wreckage and you hang on for a while. Maybe it's some physical thing. Maybe it's a happy memory or a photograph. For a while, all you can do is float, just to stay alive. In the beginning, the waves are 100 feet tall and they're crashing over you without mercy. And they don't even give you time to catch your breath. All you can do is hang on and float. And after a while, maybe weeks, maybe months, you'll find the waves are still 100 feet tall. But this time they come a little further apart. When they come, they still crash all over you and wipe you out. But in between them, you can breathe and you can function. You never know what's going to trigger the grief. It might be a song, a picture, a street intersection, the smell of a cup of coffee. It can be just about anything. And then you're gonna feel that wave come crashing again. But in between waves, there is life. Somewhere down the line, it's difficult for everybody. But you find that the waves become only 80 feet tall. And after a while, they're only 50 feet tall. And while they still come, when they come further apart, you can see them coming now. An anniversary, a birthday, or Christmas. You can see it coming for the most part and prepare yourself. And when it washes over you, you know that somehow you will again come out the other side. Maybe soaking wet, sputtering, still hanging on to some tiny piece of the wreckage, but you will come out. Take it from me, an old guy who's been through a lot. The waves never stop coming, and somehow you don't really want them to. But you learn that you'll survive them, and other waves will come, and you'll survive them too. And if you're lucky, you'll have lots of scars from lots of loves and lots of shipwrecks.